In this lecture, we are going to cover the menstrual cycle, as well as the pharmacology of hormonal contraceptives. So let's get right into it. The menstrual cycle is defined by the regular, repetitive monthly occurrence of ovulation throughout a female's reproductive life. The normal menstrual cycle results from a complex feedback system involving the hypothalamus, pituitary, ovary, and uterus. The average length of the cycle is 28 days, but this can vary between individuals and from one cycle to the next. According to convention, the cycle is divided into two phases of approximately 14 days each. The first half of the cycle is called the follicular phase. At the beginning of this phase, the hypothalamus sets the beat for the menstrual cycle by the pulsatile release of gonadotropin-releasing hormone, GnRH for short. GnRH then acts on the anterior pituitary gonadotropic cells and causes them to release two hormones, follicle-stimulating hormone, FSH for short, and luteinizing hormone, LH for short. Here we're going to use a graph to illustrate the day-to-day changes of these and other hormones in plasma that play a role in the menstrual cycle. Now, once released from the pituitary, FSH travels to the ovary, where it binds to immature eggs called oocytes, thereby initiating their maturation. As the ovarian follicles grow, they become surrounded by layers of so-called theca and granulosa cells. At this point, LH joins the party and stimulates LH receptors expressed on theca cells, causing them to produce androgens, which then diffuse into granulosa cells that, in response to FSH binding to the FSH receptors, convert them to estrogens. Going back to our graph, as a result of these events, in the first week of the cycle, we'll see slightly elevated levels of FSH and LH, and then around day 7, we'll see estrogen levels beginning to rise. Now, estrogen serves two primary purposes. Firstly, it causes uterine lining, also known as endometrium, to grow thicker in preparation for possible pregnancy. Because these endometrial changes are proliferative, this part of the uterine cycle is also called proliferative phase. Secondly, the initial rise in estrogen levels sends a negative feedback signal to the hypothalamic pituitary axis to suppress further production of FSH and LH. In addition to that, granulosa cells of the growing follicles produce another hormone called inhibin, which selectively suppresses FSH secretion. As the follicular phase progresses, out of the multiple large follicles that remain sensitive to decreasing levels of FSH, only a single dominant follicle continues to grow and produce increasing amounts of estrogen. Once again, the lining of the uterus continues to become thicker and spongier with blood-rich tissues. Now, once the estrogen levels reach a critical level as the follicle matures within the ovary, estrogen begins to exert positive feedback on LH production, which provokes a steep surge in LH and to a lesser degree FSH. Around day 14, when LH reaches its peak, it triggers the mature follicle to rupture and release the egg into fallopian tube, in a process called ovulation. This marks the end of the follicular phase and the beginning of the second half of the menstrual cycle, called luteal phase. So after ovulation, the follicle cells that used to hold the egg develop into a structure called the corpus luteum. This structure becomes a center for the production of the final key hormone, that is progesterone. Just like estrogen, progesterone helps the uterine lining to become thicker and more vascular. In addition to this, progesterone stimulates glands in the uterine wall to produce fluids necessary for the nutrition of the potential embryo, and it stimulates glands in the cervix to secrete thick mucus that closes off the uterine opening and becomes a barrier to sperm and bacteria. For this reason, this phase of the uterine cycle is also called the secretory phase. Now, going back to our graph, during the first few days following ovulation, the corpus luteum secretes high levels of progesterone, as well as lower levels of estrogen. This is why the graph shows a steep rise in progesterone and a slight bump in estrogen levels, which peak around day 21. During that same period of time, elevated levels of circulating estrogen, progesterone, and inhibin also exert a negative feedback effect on the hypothalamus and anterior pituitary thereby inhibiting secretion of GnRH, FSH, and LH, which prevents new follicles from developing. Now, if fertilization of the egg does not occur during this short period of time, the corpus luteum will start to break down, causing levels of both estrogen and progesterone to fall dramatically. It is this sudden decline in progesterone and estrogen levels that causes the uterine lining to break down and ultimately come out in the form of menstrual bleeding, also called menses, which marks the start of the next follicular phase. Now that we covered the menstrual cycle, let's move on to the second part of this lecture, that is the pharmacology of hormonal contraceptives. So, hormonal contraception refers to birth control methods that act on the endocrine system of the female to prevent ovulation or fertilization. There are two main types of hormonal contraceptives. First is the so-called combined method, which contains synthetic forms of both estrogen and progesterone. And the second is progestin-only method, which contains only progestin, that is synthetic version of progesterone. Alright, so before we discuss how each of these methods prevent pregnancy, for a reference, let's bring back our chart representing fluctuations of endogenous hormones throughout the normal phases of the menstrual cycle. Now, although hormonal contraceptives come in different forms, such as patches, injections, and vaginal rings, the most widely used form is the oral tablet, also known as the birth control pill. Combination birth control pills come in different formulations, commonly referred to as monophasic and multiphasic. In monophasic formulations, the pills deliver the same amount of estrogen and progestin each day for the first 21 days, followed by 7-day suspension or 7 days of placebo pills. Administration of exogenous estrogen and progestin leads to continuous suppression of LH and FSH output from the pituitary, which results in inhibition of ovulation. The last 7 days of suspension or placebo in turn allow estrogen and progestin levels to fall dramatically, thereby triggering so-called withdrawal bleeding that mimics the normal menstrual cycle. On the other hand, we have multiphasic formulations. In this type of combination birth control, the pills deliver varying levels of estrogen and progestin that intend to mimic the natural hormonal fluctuations as well as reduce the total exogenous hormone dose per cycle. In addition to this, with the extended cycle contraceptive regimens, women can end their menstrual periods altogether by continuously taking combined estrogen-progestin pills beyond the initial 3 weeks. Lastly, we have progestin-only birth control pills, which are useful for women who don't want long-term hormonal contraception and for whom exogenous estrogen is contraindicated because of breastfeeding or cardiovascular disease. Now, progestin-only pills are taken continuously, with no hormone-free intervals between cycles, leading to consistent suppression of FSH and endogenous progesterone production. That being said, with the exception of intramuscular dipodmetroxyprogesterone, which delivers high dose of progestin, the systemic dose of progestin delivered by all progestin-only products is relatively low. As a result, there is less suppression of endogenous estrogen levels, which allows for occasional LH surge that can trigger ovulation. Instead, progestin-only contraceptives are thought to function primarily by thickening cervical mucus and by causing endometrial atrophy. These changes inhibit egg implantation and make it more difficult for sperm to enter the uterus. Now, to end with some examples of actual drugs used in birth control products, commonly found synthetic derivatives of estrogen are ethinyl estradiol and mestranol, and synthetic derivatives of progesterone are desogestrel, drospirenone, levonorgestrel, norgestrel, norgestimate, and norethindrone. And with that, I wanted to thank you for watching. I hope you found this video useful, and as always, stay tuned for more.